Yes, thank you, Bent, and glad to be here and have the opportunity to present GomSpace. My name is Troels Nørmølle, and that's correct, I'm the CFO in GomSpace. I've been the CFO for the last 6 years, and I can tell you this is the most exciting company, but also one of the most challenging company I've ever been involved in. And one of the things I really like of being a listed company is that even then it's Sunday evening or Sunday night, we still have a press release going out, so I had that experience yesterday when I arrived here. So today I'm going to present GomSpace. I will go through what is we are selling, the nanosatellites, why this is a disrupting technology. I'll tell you about our business model and our market potential that we see as a long growth potential. I'll go through some customer cases, and then I'll end up with some of our financials. But before we start, this is actually a good way just to introduce GomSpace. What you see on the picture here is a satellite. You have in the middle the box that's 20 centimeter, 40 centimeters, and 10 centimeters. So it's relatively small satellite. And then you can see on the side you have these wings that is flapping out, that's solar panels to generate power for the satellite. And in the picture two, you can actually see more satellites in the background. And that's because when you enter this industry, you need more satellites to cover the Earth and the globe. So first of all, we have our team here. We have Niels Buus, who's the VD of GomSpace. He's been in the company also for 6 years. Before that, he was actually chairman in the company. We have our chief sales officer, chief technology officer, and also our chief manufacturing officer on the picture. And then we also have the board led by Jukka Pertola, who's the chairman. So if I should give a short introduction, GomSpace at a glance. We are a company, relatively young. We are established in 2007. We are a company who has its offspring from Denmark and Aalborg University. We have subsidiaries here in Sweden, in Uppsala. We have a main manufacturing part in Aalborg. We have a lot of software development in Luxembourg, and then we have sales office in the US, and we also have a representative office in Singapore. So we are a truly born global company selling our products to the entire world. We have, with our products, been involved and having our products in more than 50 missions in space. Right now we are around 175 employees, and we have been listed since June 2016. And if you see the on the below closest to me, you can see if we have this average growth of roughly almost 60% during the last 5 years. Oh, sorry about that. You can also see that our gross margin has been decreasing. I'll tell a little more about that, but we have been investing a lot in building up this company. If we should say what is that we highlight about GomSpace, and first of all, what we are focusing on in the space sector is radio technology, because you can do very advanced missions with small devices when it comes to radio technology. And we are the market leader in that area, and that's what the company was basically based upon. When you go into space, the second thing is flawless, that you have space-proven products, meaning that you can demonstrate to all of your stakeholders, especially your customers, that your product has been in space, operating in space, and actually performing in space. And it may sound simple, but you should remember, when you send our assets into space, you have no chance of repair them afterwards. So they need to work first time, and they need to work in the entire lifetime in space. And we have demonstrated that in several missions so far. And the last one is that we have secured most orders within this industry in the small satellite, nanosatellites, and the major prime in this is European Space Agency. And European Space Agency is the one who is drift this market and stress all the technology to its limits. And we have secured a big part of the ESA orders and still do. And as you can see, we are a truly global company. We sell our products and our services to the entire world. And the area that is that has been the biggest part of our revenue and business is within the commercial area. I'll explain a little more about that later on. So, our business model. You see the subsystems, platforms, payloads, constellation management, and then you have different business segments. So it starts, we sell off-the-shelf products that goes into the satellite, so you can actually buy all the products yourself and assemble your own satellites. And we're selling these products directly into these four segments. But we want to capture more of the value, so we also seek to sell platforms and even add payloads on top of the satellite. So that's where you're taking all of these components and then integrate it into a spaceship, a small spaceship, and then you add the instrument, that's the payload. My microphone, sorry about that. And then you have a spaceship working in space. Then when it's up and running in space, we also provide constellation management. And that's where how you operate the satellite when they're already in space. And we also support that mission. So we go the entire value chain from manufacturing the satellites, designing the satellites, design them first, of course, and then manufacture them, and also operate them on behalf of our customers in space. Then we're also providing additional service. That can be, for example, launch procurement. When you need to have a satellite in space, you need to have somebody to make sure that you can buy that from some of the rocket providers. You also need consultancy when it comes to license, the frequency that you operate your satellite on. We sell this into four different segments. We have the academia, that's the universities, and we have been selling our products to more than 70 universities worldwide. I briefly mentioned that the science, the next one, that's European Space Agency. We also have NASA and other agency around the world that we're selling our solutions to. Then we have the defense area. We have, for example, selling one of our satellites for the Danish defense, doing surveillance on the Arctic, on Greenland. And then we have the commercial area, and that's where we see the biggest potential. And that's customer who wants to do some kind of service with the satellites and the data we can collect from our satellites. We truly believe that we are disrupting the satellite business, the traditional satellite business. That's why we name it New Space. So what we do, what we try to explain on this slide is how mainframe computer was disrupted by PC computers, how the phone industry, the cell phone industry, was disrupted by the smartphone. And what we seek to illustrate in the bottom of this picture, on this picture, is a traditional large satellite. You can actually see, it's not that easy, but you can see a man standing next to the satellite. So it's a big satellite, custom made. It has a lot of advanced and very expensive components, where we seek to do satellites with standard components, and then we seek to drive down the price, reduce the price all the time, so we can be much more competitive. Doing that, we are able to sell our products, our satellites, to a fraction of the traditional space and the traditional satellites. And that's basically what we seek to do. We believe that we have a huge market potential. If you look at some of the numbers, without going into the details, then the satellite market is 300 billion. Some of that can be solved with our products, and we have estimated roughly that out of the manufacturing part, we will roughly be able to harvest like 3 billion of that market, of the current market. But we actually see that the market will expand, and we also increase with the constellation management on top of that. That's why we're actually saying our market potential is more than 6 billion US dollars. So there's a lot of potential, and we see that this market will grow for long term. There's actually reports saying that this market will grow to 3 or 4 trillion and not that far away in the future. So there's a long term potential when it comes to new space and satellites. We're not alone in this industry. We have some competitors. We have one here in Sweden, Clydespace AOC Microtech, who are in more or less the similar industry that we do. We have a competitor in Holland called ISIS, and we have two competitors in the US called Tyvek and Blue Canyon. And in this industry, there's always new companies who wants to go into this industry because it's growing as it is. And we actually welcome that kind of competition because we need to be more companies certifying and make the nanosatellites available for a larger crew, for a larger target group. And we believe that we have a strong position in this market. We are the company who has invested the most. And therefore, we actually think that competition is a healthy thing in this environment and this industry. This is probably a little small, but you can probably see, and I'll not go through all of them. But this is just to give you some example of what is that we are servicing and what is it that we are selling to some of our customers. And if you take the two AES Tech and Unseen Labs and actually also in some way Clears, they are all within the commercial area, and they all of them operate when it comes to asset tracking, and in this case it's tracking of ships, so that's AES signals. So what they do, we provide them the infrastructure, the hardware, and also a system on the running the satellites, where they focus on a dedicated payload and instrument that we have developed together with the customer and put on board on the satellite. Then they harvest some data, and then they transform this data, putting analytics on the data, and they sell, our customers sell that data to, for example, agency. Take Clears, for example, they are, for example, selling their service to Coast Guard, so border control, illegal fishing outside Africa, or oil under embargo that you want to move and you want to track. We also have aerial and maritime. They want to do a billing machine for tracking airplanes, so you can like road pricing just in the sky. We have the example into the bottom. That's the defense area where we, for example, have the Danish government. We also have a customer in Colombia who wants to track what's going on. That's more for intelligence purpose. So this is an illustration of what kind of products we already are delivering to. Of a lot of them we have already finished. So this is what makes GomSpace unique. That is that we have demonstrated that we can produce the manufacture the hardware. We can actually make them running in space and demonstrating that they are working. That's kind of the offspring for the next path of GomSpace. So we have been in a distress situation where one of our larger customers suddenly wasn't able to finance their own plans. And doing that, we have actually reduced our employees with more than almost 35% during the last 9 months. This has made that we are struggling getting our earnings on track. We are not delivering exactly as we have estimated when we some years ago, but what is the point now, or what we want to state now, is that now we have reduced the staff, we have cut a lot of costs, and now the company are actually looking forward. We still believe that we will able to have a gross margin above 50%. And this slide shows the development in our staff. As you can see, the black column is full-time staff, and the green is headcount when you count on the specific day. And for many years, we have always increased our staffing, but since we have been cutting a lot of costs and we have optimizing a lot of internal working with efficiency within the company, we are actually now decreasing our staffing. Another important thing is that we always seek to keep the selling, general administration cost on a balanced level, and that's why we always seek to have that as less and less part of the overall employment. That's what you can see in the two lines at the bottom. So most people in a GomSpace should be in the engineering and in the manufacturing part. That's important for us. That's where we create the value for our customers too. Being a company who have invested a lot, it's always important that we can demonstrate that we have enough cash to go through this process. We raised some capital December 2018, and we have roughly 180 million in cash in bank. So we have sufficient cash to go through this restructuring plan that we are going through right now. When it comes to risk in GomSpace, customer risk is a big part of it. A lot of our customers are new companies. We also have traditional companies, but a lot of our customers are new companies. And that's why working capital is a very important thing for us. It's always important for us that we manage the risk on the customer by making sure that they pay in milestones payment. And if we do so, then we can actually avoid having losses on the customer. And that's why we seek to have a working capital around zero, and that's the black column. As you can see, we haven't succeeded that fully, but we strive to have it around zero all the time. So, last financial statement. Here you have our order backlog. And as you can see, it's for a long time have a backlog of more than 700 million. And as you can see in the last quarter here, the half-year report, we decided to remove one of the biggest order on this specific customer called Skyspace and Global. So now we actually have an order backlog at around 120 million. So we're kind of having a new entry level in that way. The good thing is that we see orders coming in. I can say daily because it has yesterday, but we see a lot of more spread and we see us increasing the order backlog day by day. And that's still supporting us in this industry, and we have a huge growth potential. So, we haven't changed our long-term ambition, our mid-term ambition. We still strive on the medium term, meaning not yet next year, but the year after 2021, to have a gross margin above 50%. We still aim to have a revenue above 1.5 billion on long term, so that's meaning 2023. And as you can see here, the numbers, we have been growing. Right now, we're in a phase where it goes a little more flat, building up the momentum in the order backlog, and then we are prepared, we have optimized the company, and we are ready to start growing the company once again. Yeah.
Very interesting presentation, and now we have time for some questions. I can start right away here. You said the satellite market is a $300 billion market.
Yes, that's last year's value. Yeah,
and it's expected to increase like tenfold in 10 years or?
Yeah, if we go into the market potential, then the overall market will probably grow with something like 6-7%. So that's also an over normal growth in general. But then if you reduce it to where we come in, and that's the manufacturing and the constellation part, and then you go into this niche called small satellites, that will grow significantly more than the rest of the market because you have two things generally happening. You have a migration from the traditional satellites into lower cost nano satellites. So that's one of the market development. That's where we are capturing the same market. At the same way, you see market potential grow. Some of the customer cases like Clias, Air and Maritime, these kind of services was not part of the market before because to have access to this kind of data was simply too expensive. So now you actually see the market is growing with new companies going into the market.
Okay. And when you say here that the commercial sector is increasing, how is this regulated? Is it room for everyone in space, or can it pose dangers for space?
The way it's regulated is that it's a United Nations regulation. So each country is responsible for all the assets that they send up. So if we send up a satellite registered here in Sweden, then it's actually the Swedish government who is responsible for the remaining part of the world for that satellite. So the Swedish government will probably not take that responsibility on their own. So they will ask the operator of the satellite, and we are often involved in that, to put an insurance on the satellites. And that's the way it's regulated. So you need to have a permit from the governmental, and they typically want you to have insurance on your satellite, so if it should go wrong. So that's more how it's regulated to get it up there. And another part of the regulation is that they also want to make sure that you bring the satellite out of orbit, meaning like when it's done, when it's operation, you need to take it away from space. And the way we do that, that's actually one of the companies, like the company we have here in Sweden, in Uppsala, where we make propulsion units. So we can actually steer the satellite near the Earth, and then when it comes close enough, it will actually start burning up in the atmosphere. So that's the way we actually clean up after ourselves. And that will be a requirement. So it is an important thing. Take, for example, pollution in the ocean. People talked about that many years ago, but nobody come up with a solution. Too many spaceships in space could also be one day be a situation, maybe in 30 years or something. But we already now have the instruments and the tools actually to solve it from the beginning. So we're actually glad that they put this kind of requirement on the permits that from the governmental. It's better to have a regulated market.
Okay. And when you look at, you mentioned you have a competitor here in Sweden, ORC, Microtech.
Yes, yeah. LC, Clyde Space, I think they called it. Yeah.
What is the main difference between you and them? Do you have different?
I would say that one of the difference is that we have been raising more capital, so we have invested a lot of money. I don't know exactly the peer, but also when it comes to employees, I think we are significantly larger in that way. I think they're doing a good job. I think they're very successful on securing orders. So the difference is also that I guess we have secured a lot of orders from European Space Agency. I'm not sure. I think we're also much more involved in the constellation management. So taking the turnkey where we design, manufacture, and also operate the satellites afterwards. That's where the niche that we are trying to get in, to be this turnkey provider. I think that they will probably or are also involved in the same kind. So I don't think there's that big difference between the two companies. Going back to your question about the market potential, I don't see an issue in having more companies within this industry. There's plenty of room for all of us to grow significantly.
So your business model will be you will partly sell the satellite and then also get a continuous payment for looking after it, so to speak,
yeah,
and steer
yeah.
it. And
we are selling an infrastructure system, so we are developing it. We are developing the infrastructure. We are also manufacturing, sending it up. And then we're also doing the constellation, meaning that we make sure that it's up and running as it should after we launch it. And then you have this continuous replacement of satellites. So that's why it's important to be very integrated in that area.
How long do they stay in orbit?
We aim, like, typically we say about 5-6 years in orbit, and then you replace them. And the reason that you replace them, it could actually be possible to increase the lifetime in space, but it's also technology driven. So you want all the time to have the new components on the satellites, and then you can replace it ongoing. Take, for example, if you have a traditional satellite that was maybe have a lifetime of more than 20 years, then you produce some kind of receiver on the satellites, and then you have to wait 20 years before you can replace it. Maybe all the ships replace all of their terminals. So if you have ongoing replacement, you can adapt the system, this infrastructure, ongoing. Okay. So that's a huge advantage of the nanosatellites compared to traditional space.
Okay. Let's see if we have some questions in the audience. Yes.
Yes. Yes, we do.
I can repeat the question, so it's for the viewers. You said you will bring it back to Earth from space. Does it mean that you manage it also in low orbit? What was that question?
Yes. Maybe I can just explain.
So yes.
You divide space into three. You have LEO, low Earth orbit, as you mentioned. Then you have MEO, mid Earth orbit, and then you have GEO, where you're talking about geostationary satellites. So this is the difference is how far away the satellites are for the surface of the Earth. And our satellites are around 800, 1200 kilometers away from the surface, and that's where we're operating. We actually are involved in some projects from European Space Agency, where we're going into deep space, where we're using some of our satellites going into mining of asteroids. So some of our satellites are actually brought on board on a bigger spaceship, brought out to far away, and then sent in orbit on some far away asteroids. But it doesn't change anything. Our satellites are small, designed to be in low Earth orbit.
Okay. Can this be used? They're talking about returning to the moon again or going to Mars. Could your satellite be used for that missions?
Our satellites will not fly to the moon or to Mars. They will be brought on board on a spaceship, on a rocket that will bring them there. But the reason that you use our satellites into this is that you decrease the risk of maybe a larger asset. And it's not that, I think it was both from Israel and there was another country here recently who failed landing their assets on the moon. So to de-risk some of the missions, even if you go even far away, then you can actually launch one of our satellites, put it in orbit around this moon, for example, or that could be Mars or whatever, and then you can scan that planet, and then you can de-risk when you actually try to land with the larger assets on the moon. Okay. So it's part of the mission. But this is something that we are glad to be involved in. It's very important because we develop our technology. We make sure that we go into an environment where it's much more harsh. So we need to strengthen and improve a lot of our products. And those improvements we can bring to our more commercial and regular satellites.
Okay. Let's see if we have some more questions here in the audience. Yes, once again. Who is your main provider of lodging facilities?
Yeah, the rockets. Okay, yeah, that's actually we don't have a preferred partner on rocket providers. I think I saw a piece, an analyst here recently, that there are more than 100 companies who seeks to launch rocket into space, and that's a lot. Recently, we have been working together with the Virgin Orbit, that's a part of Richard Branson's brand. We've been working, last customer I actually think it was with the Rocket Lab and US company. So there's a lot of these providers, SpaceX, as some of you maybe know, also into rocket market. So like the increasing amount of companies going into this industry, there's also a lot of rocket providers who wants to take a part of that. So we don't have a preferred partner. We source by various rocket providers.
Okay. And so all the, you mentioned the SpaceX and Richard Branson's endeavor. Is that why do they build the rockets? Is that for the satellite industry, or is it for? What is really driving the space industry as a whole, so to speak? Because it's quite large sums of money.
As you make access to space cheaper, then the volume go up. So it's some kind of a demand supply equation. More and more service can be done when we go when we lower the price, and when we lower the price, then this the rugged providers can also have volume in their companies, and that's actually what's driving them to. And they believe, like us, that this market is going to be a big market in the future. So that's why they are investing too. Okay.
And unfortunately, we have run out of time. But thank you for a very interesting presentation.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.